Thank you guys for tuning in to this week's edition of the Lin-Mass Sportscast. I'm Sean Donahue.
And I'm Jessica Starber. We have another jam-packed show for you. We're going to talk to a runner who ran this year's Boston Marathon.
We'll also get a good look at lacrosse and Lin on this week's edition of the Coach's Corner.
And we're also going to check out some workout moves that some of our athletes can do to stay in top form with one of the area's best athletic trainers. But first, let's get started with some baseball with this week's Game of the Week.
Good evening, everybody, and welcome to Frazier Field for Catholic Central League Baseball. Hit high and deep to left field, way back and gone for a home run. First one we've seen this year. Strike three called. Good fastball by Costanza. Brian Nerick hits it in a right center field for a base hit. He gets the first hit for the Spartans. The runner takes off. He got a good jump, and the ball's hit right by the second baseman. Great hit and run. Chop to third. They're not going to make a play at the plate. They'll have to go to first. They get the tying run. Hit to first base. Hatchell. Hatchell was going to try and go get it himself, and he kind of slipped a little bit. Last minute, he flipped it. And Costanza hustled over and made the play. Good job on both ends. The hitter takes off. The throw down to second. They got him. Good throw by Nerick. Strike three called. Waves at that one for strike three. Lined in the left center field for a base hit. Boisel will score easily. Nerick with a big two-out hit. His second hit. He's been involved in both. He scored the first run. He knocks in the second run. Strike three called. Fastball on the outside corner. They were getting ready to throw the ball to second base. They didn't have to. Hit in the air behind shortstop. Long run for the center fielder. It's going to drop for a base hit. Curve ball again. And he backed way away from that one. He ducked out of the way and takes it for strike three. Curveball, swing and a miss. They strike him out. Nerick will throw him out at first. Back-to-back strikeouts for Costanza, who pitched a tremendous game. Outstanding effort by Matt Costanza.
Taking a look at news around the city, the classical softball team is back from a trip to Florida. There, they played in a couple of different tournaments at Disney's Wide World of Sports. They played teams from all across the country, so a great job by those girls, making the city proud at the national level.
Congratulations to the Rams, and Little League season is officially underway. Leagues from across the city held their opening day ceremonies last weekend. Players, family, and city officials were all down at the games to make sure that their season started off with a bang.
And a local Lin sports legend is going to be honored over the weekend. John Hoffman, he's a local Lin sports journalist. He's going to be honored at a testimonial at Nahant Country Club over the weekend. There they will honor his 30 years of service to the Lin sports scene. And I've had the very fortunate chance to work with John Hoffman a couple of different times over the years as I've been trying to up and come and become a good sports journalist from this city. He's just a wealth of knowledge. He's like an encyclopedia.
Absolutely.
He knows everything from players past and present, and even the ones that are up and coming. So he's definitely someone to look out for.
30 years is a long time, and if you look up selfless in the dictionary, I'm sure there's a picture of John right next to it. Congratulations, John, on a fantastic career, and we're happy they're making sure that it's well known as well.
Well, 36,000 runners ran this year's Boston Marathon, a year after last year's tragic bombings. One of those runners was a local elementary teacher. I got a chance to sit down with her and see what the race was like from a runner's perspective. Check it out. We're sitting down with Phyllis Fogarty. She is a second grade teacher at Druids Elementary School right here in Lynn, and she ran this year's Boston Marathon. So as a runner, describe what the Boston Marathon means to you.
Well, I think the marathon is an event for the whole city of Boston, not just for the runners, but for people in the community that come out and support everybody.
Mm-hmm. Last year, you ran last year's race. Where were you when the bombs went off?
I actually was finished. I had finished 30 minutes prior. I was on Newbury Street collecting myself. And we heard, you know, a loud noise and just thought it was a construction vehicle. And then another loud noise, and we figured there was something really going on. And that's when we decided to leave town.
And when you found out that there was kind of an attack on the marathon, as a runner who's ran it before, what did you think?
Well, being that I didn't actually see it, mm-hmm. I can't really say that I was affected the way other people were. Mm-hmm. However, after I sat down and thought about it, it was unbelievable, hard to describe how someone could take a special event like that and just, you know, do something like that.
So last year was supposed to be your last marathon. What made you decide to run this year's race?
Well, I kind of felt like I needed to, even though, like I said, I wasn't personally affected, that it affected the whole running community, and I needed to come back and sort of take back the fact that the race is ours, and no one could take that away from any of us.
Absolutely. So when you got on the bus to head down to the starting line, what was the mood like? Was it any different than in years past?
It seemed like people were talking more, just having more discussions. A lot of people came back just for the fact that, because of what happened last year, that's what I found anyway, the people that I spoke to, that they just felt like it was something they had to do.
And this was a record-breaking year. There were 36,000 runners. Did you notice the difference at all in just the volume of runners at this year's race?
Not really, because you do go off in different waves. But as far as the crowds, I did notice a bigger crowd.
You did?
Yes.
Where in particular did you think there were a little bit more people or just a different energy?
I think it was a different energy. There were more people everywhere. I mean, pretty much the whole route. They were 5 and 6 deep along the sides. Kenmore Square was packed. It just was the energy, the signs, just people cheering. It just was amazing.
We hear from runners all the time saying it's really those crowds that lift you. Is that true?
It really is. I mean, it's hard to believe that, but it really is. When you really are hurting and struggling and you see people cheering for you, you just feel that burst of energy, that motivation to keep going.
And did you see any runners in particular that were running for certain causes related to last year's event?
I did. I saw the Martin Richards, a couple of people with their shirts on, and I saw Dick Hoyt, who was running with his son, who wasn't supposed to run again, with his group. So yeah, it was, you know, there were a lot of emotions that, you know, you felt as you ran. You couldn't help it.
Yeah, any particular time did you think back to last year's race and why you were running this year?
I did at times throughout, and I did at times when I was struggling think, you know, the pain that I'm feeling is temporary. The pain that those people are feeling is for a lifetime. So I just, that kind of motivates you to keep going.
And when you turned down on Boylston Street, what was that emotion like this year?
Well, I think the last turn is always emotional because you've run this incredibly long journey and you're finally seeing the finish line. So you do kind of get that chill, you know, as you run anyway. But it was a little difficult this year, you know, knowing where the bombs had gone off, looking left, looking right. I took my headphones off just so I could hear the crowds. And I just tried to kind of block that out and just to get to the finish line and, you know, make it a good ending.
Do you think that Boston took back the race?
Oh, absolutely. It was a wonderful day. Great day.
Awesome. Well, you have your medal on. Congratulations on another successful marathon.
Thank you.
Now we're going to head over to the Coach's Corner with Sean Donahue.
Welcome to the Coach's Corner. Thank you, Jessica. Here with me today, some of the Spartans baseball players. We have Brian Nerick and Alec Costanza of the St. Mary Spartans. Guys, I just want to thank you for being here today.
Thank you.
I know you guys are mid-season right now. Baseball over at St. Mary's is a huge, huge sport. There's a lot of interest. And from what I understand, you guys get some pretty great coaches to help you out, too. Before we get too much into the team, into St. Mary's, let's talk a little bit about you guys, your backgrounds. How did you get started in baseball, and how did you find yourself in the Spartans?
I found myself, like my dad, when I was really young. I always loved baseball when he was younger, and he wanted me to feel the same way, so he got me playing Little League and just fell in love with the game that way.
Now, Brian, is this like a tradition in your family? I mean, does it go back to even before your dad?
Yeah, my grandfather went to St. Mary's. Then my dad went to St. Mary's, played baseball. My Uncle Timmy and Uncle Mark played baseball with my coaches right now. and then my aunts had played softball at St. Mary's.
Holy smokes, so you're what we would call a legacy. Keep up the good work and keep it in the family without a doubt. Now, Alec, let's get into your background. How'd you find yourself playing baseball at St. Mary's?
I've always been a baseball guy. My dad's a, you know, he's actually a dentist, so he's not really like big athletic guy, but I've always just had some interest in baseball and AAU and all of that. So St. Mary's looked really good for me. Okay. And I knew like the coaches were really big on that, just taking to academics and baseball too. So it was a good fit.
Heck yeah. So over at St. Mary's, I actually coach football with Coach Dana and Coach Donahue. And I know that we're always drilling our guys and trying to instill some values in them. You know, teamsmanship. We're not afraid to say I love you to each other. You know, it's all about family. Family's first, and then you get school, and then you get your team, then you've got your extracurricular, then you're last on the list of priorities. So tell me a little bit about some of the values that your coach is trying to instill in you. Brian, we'll start with you.
Coach Dana, his number one thing, he wants us to be coachable. Like, he also wants us to have a little bit of talent too, but if we're coachable and can do things his way, then he knows that we can be in a good spot to succeed.
Okay. Alec, what about you?
He talks a lot about just having fun. You know, he'll make a couple jokes here and there, and we'll have like laughs in and out, but it's all hard work. Okay. All hard work all the time.
Good news. So I'm not sure if you guys are aware of this, but Coach Donahue, Coach Dana, and Coach Fila all played baseball together in high school. Mm-hmm. And they're actually going to be inducted into the St. Mary's Hall of Fame for their 81 team. I mean, I'm not sure whether or not that's special to you, but it must be easy to look up to coaches when they've got credentials like that. What's it like playing for these guys?
Like he said, we'll have fun, but when it comes down to it, they know what they're doing and they know how to put us in the best position to win.
Okay. Alec, you got anything to add?
Just basically that. It's a lot looking up to them. Basically.
Okay. So, they make it easy on you. Let's talk a little bit about being a student athlete at St. Mary's. There's newer administration over there. I know that the school is very tight-knit. It's an awesome community. Mm-hmm. I'm a Lynn Classical grad. So, you know, I went through all the hate English, football, was all that stuff. And, you know, based on my experience coaching at St. Mary's, it's really cool, man. I mean, like, the fact that it's such a small school, I mean, and you're on, like, a campus almost. Like, mm-hmm. I mean, it's totally St. Mary's there. And, we had talked to Jeff Newhall on our show about some of the stuff that they're trying to establish over there. And it is a culture, without a doubt. Tell me a little bit about your experience, Brian, as a student athlete.
Well, obviously, school comes first for any kid at St. Mary's. But, like, it's so small that you can go to any teacher, ask for help, go to them, and they're not too busy for you. They'll always be there to help you no matter what, and it's always nice to have that.
It's an amazing facility, like overall, like your library, everything's like state of the art there. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. One of the big things now is iPads. You guys all have iPads.
Yeah.
Everyone's
yeah.
walking around with iPads. Yeah. Realistically, I know you're probably playing games on them, but at the same time, they're great tools for studying. So you've got that advantage as well. Alec, let's get into your experience as a student athlete.
Absolutely. Obviously, like Brian said, school definitely comes first when it comes to athletics. It's definitely like a family over there, and I felt that when I came in at seventh grade, because they have a junior high there too, but it's honestly, from the teachers, the kids, everything, it's just felt like a good, approachable family in every way.
All right. Now let's talk about the baseball team. There's pretty rich history of baseball over at St. Mary's. Your coaches are history. You're making history right now. You guys are seniors. You've been playing for the past 4 years. If you went to St. Mary's earlier, you were probably playing before then. Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit about the team. What's it like playing at playing at St. Mary's?
I love it because like we're all like the whole team's very close. Like we're not like we don't have like just groups of each kids like talking to each other.
No cliques.
Like we can all like talk to each other. Like I could go up to like a kid who really doesn't play as much and just talk to him because like he's my friend, he's in my class or something like that. It's not like one person's more important than the other.
Okay. Alec, anything to add?
Basically just the same thing as that. And I think just playing under the name of St. Mary's too, it's always been a big wig name. Tony Conigliaro, it's always just, Yeah.
That's a good point. Yeah, there's a lot of history there other than just, what's going on with in baseball. I mean, like,
they've got history for football, they've got history for basketball even now.
Definitely.
Days, it's like a big, huge game over there. Now, you guys are seniors. You won't be able to stay at St. Mary's forever, unfortunately, mm-hmm. and I know that makes you upset. But you must have some plans from college.
Mm-hmm. I got accepted to the University of Westfield State.
Congratulations.
And that's where I'll be attending.
Home
actually.
Of the Owls.
Yep.
Now, you're going to play baseball there?
Yes, I am.
What about sport? Any other sports that you play at St. Mary's?
I played basketball like freshman and junior year, but then I ran track this year.
Okay, so baseball is your sport.
Yes.
Alex?
Suffolk University for me next year, and yeah, we'll be playing baseball there too.
What about studying? What are you trying to study?
You first.
I'm going into criminal justice.
Cool.
Global business and finance.
Global business and finance?
Yeah.
That sounds a lot more significant than anything that I've ever taken in my life. It was usually one-on-one courses. Guys, I wish you the best of luck. I want to thank you for being on the show. And keep playing, man. Keep playing. Here with me in the coach's corner now, Sean Anderson, head coach of the St. Mary's lacrosse team, and Peter Papp, head coach of the Lynn lacrosse team. Guys, thanks for being here. Today, we're here to talk about lacrosse and Lynn. As coaches, we're well aware that it's a secondary sport. It's not really that much interest because there's a lack of youth teams around here. But before we get into all that stuff, let's learn a little bit about yourselves, your background, and how you got into coaching. Sean, we'll start with you.
So, Sean, I started probably coaching college football maybe 30 years ago. Did some colleges all over the country from Boston University to a school in West Virginia. Before I get in the college game, I was a high school guy at a couple different high schools. And then how I get into lacrosse is kind of interesting. I was coaching at a small DV3 school out in Worcester, Becker College, and we had a staff meeting one day, and the athletic director came in and said, "Hey, I need a lacrosse coach." And I knew he was coming after me. I just knew it. And I didn't really like the sport, didn't know enough about the sport. And so as the meeting's going on there, and he goes, "Do I have any volunteers?" And of course, nobody raises their hand. And he goes, "Coach, I need you to do it." And then one thing led into another, and my passion for the game has grown, and it's a great sport. I like it a lot.
It is. It's a great game. You know, I got involved because I played a classical. Peter, you're a classical guy as well. Now you teach at English, but you coach English and classical. I got into the game because my coach at the time came up and he said, "Hey, you're a football guy." I said, "Yeah." And he goes, "If we gave you a 6-foot pole and asked you to hit somebody, would you want to play a game?"
There you go.
And I was like, "I'm in." So that's good stuff. So you were in the right place at the right time at Becker, and that translated over to St. Mary's. Good.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah.
So Peter, let's talk a little bit about your background, how you got involved.
Well, I started out, played lacrosse in high school. I was on the first team at Lynn Classical High School.
That's right.
Played 3 years, went on and played a couple years at Salem State in college. And then after that, graduated, wound up substitute teaching and teaching at Lynn Classical. Hooked on as a assistant coach and the JV coach over there for my first 2 years, and the coaching vacancy came available. So put my name in, got lucky to get hired, been the head coach for 5 years now.
And I think you're doing a fantastic job. All your athletes, good kids, they're very respectable. Yes sir, no sir, all that stuff. So continue doing awesome work. Now let's talk a little bit from a coaching standpoint, all right? A lot of people don't understand that coaching, winning is more so on like the third on the list of priorities,
sure.
Fourth on the list of priorities. It's more about instilling values into your players and your athletes and trying to teach them the right ways to go through life, making decisions, very important, holding yourself accountable. Let's talk about the values that you try to pass on to your athletes, Sean.
Well, Sean, one of the things I try to do at St. Mary's is try to have the student athlete find out about themselves, what they're capable of doing. You know, sometimes it's not easy being a student athlete, and you got to make certain sacrifices, and you got to commit.
Yeah.
And so that's hard, again, for a young, student athlete, 16, 17-year-old kid.
Yeah, especially during the spring season, because that's when spring break is. A big conflict that we deal with sometimes, it hasn't been this year, but spring break, vacation, kids
sure.
going out, weddings, that stuff happens. Peter, let's talk a little bit about the values that you try to instill
in
your players.
The commitment is obviously the biggest problem, especially with no youth program, with these kids just starting playing the sport within the last few years. To have that level of commitment is difficult because it's not been a commitment for them for their past 10, 15 years of life, like
right.
say their football programs were or their hockey programs were. So getting them to appreciate the commitment to the lacrosse program to be equal as all those other sports that they've played is one of the toughest challenges that I run into.
Sure.
I will say this year has been better than ever, and I will say not to say it was a good thing, but the weather being cold every day doesn't hurt us in the long run.
Right, yeah,
because,
yeah, yeah.
We lose one of the side distractions that becomes a big thing in this time of the year, which is the beach sounds really good, and
sure.
a couple
nice
losses here and there,
in.
And then the nice weather becomes a difficult challenge.
Definitely. Now, we're talking about commitment right now. From a coaching standpoint, there's a boatload of commitment that you need to make. On the field, off the field, talking to parents, talking to kids, making sure that they're doing the right things. Sean, you're a sub at St. Mary's, so
yep.
you get hands-on approach. What are some of the sacrifices you deal with as a head coach?
Personally or for the team?
For yourself, personally.
You know, Sean, one of the things, you know, being a substitute teacher, you don't make a lot of money. That's one thing. One of the reasons I do the substitute teaching is to be around my kids, to know if they're acting up, to know if they're having a great day, to know if they're having a problem. And again, I want to be there for them, to, you know, show my support for them.
Definitely. Sean? Sorry, Peter?
For me, it's, I mean, coaching's a 24/7 job, so there's yeah. really no free time from coaching. I mean,
sure.
I hear from my kids day, night, this problem, that problem. I'm in school with them. I coach in English, which more than half of my team is a student at.
Nice.
So, I mean, I'm around my kids all day long. I have a few of them in class. I help them. I wrote recommendations for a lot of my kids for their colleges.
Sure.
So there's a lot of the additionals on top of the coaching that come into play.
Go ahead.
I think some of the rewards, Sean, coaching, again, none of us are going to get rich.
Yeah.
But it's little things. I'll give you a quick story about myself. I had one of my players, Merrimack football player, call me up. Again, we stay in touch. And he says, Coach, I'm getting married. I said, congratulations. You know, the whole nine yards. I had met his fiance at the time. And he goes, I want you to be in the wedding. And I said to the kid, I'm too old to be in your wedding. You don't want me. He goes, nope. I go, I need it. I insist. And that was pretty flattering to me.
No, yeah.
To be in, you know, again. And that's what, for me, that's what coaching is about, is the lifetime bonds that you make with these kids and,
yeah.
you know, to be there for them if they should need you and, you know.
That's something yeah. I'm definitely looking forward to, you know, as a coach, is being able to see your guys succeed, get a job in the real world, and also be able to kind of be like, I told you so.
Sure, yeah.
It's not hard. It's not easy. So, without a doubt, from my standpoint in coaching, when I first came in, you know, Coach Durgan, Coach Dana, Tom Donahue, Bobby Mulvey, Coach Wattler, those guys kind of brought me under their wing and tried to explain the game to me, not just football, but the game of coaching.
Sure.
It's not just showing up to practice or the games. It's watching film, forcing your guys to watch film. I mean, Coach Durgan's down at the weight room every single day in the off season, making sure that these kids are lifting. And that's the type of commitment that you need to build a winning program.
Sure.
Peter, you got a tough job, man. You're the head coach of the Lynn lacrosse team, Lynn Shamrocks, and it's composed of two of the biggest rivals in the whole entire state, English and classical. And then they have to play together. Tell me about that.
Well, I mean, surprisingly, for the most part, it's been pretty good over the years. I mean, we've had a couple kids who haven't been able to handle the crosstown rivalry coming together and have chose not to play because of it. But for the most part, our kids do a great job of coming together, a lot better than expected. I mean, this year we have captains of the football team from English on the team. And the benefit, another benefit for us actually, is that the Lynn Jets are a composition of classical, English, and tech.
Right.
So half of my team comes from the hockey aspect, and they're all used to playing with each other, luckily. But the general mentality, I mean, I don't think I don't know how I would have played if I was, or how well I would have
yeah.
been at the equation when I was in high school
right.
at classical, being told that I was playing with English.
Right.
So they're more mature than I think I was at
yeah.
that same age level.
I think so, too. And, you know, we come down there, we see your guys working out, and they're all buddy-buddy. They're all, you know, fans of each other, which is
yeah.
great. But yeah, back in my day, we talked about this before the show. I knew that I didn't like English, but I wasn't sure why. But I knew that if I stopped not liking them, that I would have a problem among my peers. So
yeah.
It's interesting. I mean, nowadays I support all sports in Lynn, all football players, all lacrosse players, all baseball players, whatever the case may be. I think that these guys nowadays have a huge challenge, but at the same time, they're learning that life lesson. Sometimes you got to work alongside some guys who maybe aren't, you know, what you're used to. And I think that that's great what you guys are doing over there. Lynn isn't a very popular It isn't a very popular sport here. I think it's attributed to the lack of youth teams, without a doubt. And, I mean, it would be great to see that come up. We were talking before the show about what we can do to build lacrosse up in Lynn. So for those of you at home who are watching, make sure you keep an eye out for any upcoming lacrosse clinics, youth practices, things like that, because we will be working on it. Guys, thanks for being here. Let's go to the question of the week. Question of the week, tweet your answers to our Twitter handle, at Lynn Sportscast, for your chance to win a free pizza from Tony Lena's on Boston Street. Last week's question, in 1962, Wilt Chamberlain set the record for most points in a game with 100. The record for most points in a half stands at 59. Who holds it? We had asked these guys before the interview who had it. Coach Anderson said Larry Bird, and Coach Papp actually got it right. It's a trick question. It was Wilt Chamberlain. He did it on the same day. So nobody answered that question. No pizza for you. This week's question, nickname the kid. This Red Sox legend set the single-season hitting record in 1941 with an average of 406. Who was it? Again, tweet your answers to our Twitter handle, at Lynn Sportscast, for your chance to win a free pizza from Tony Lena's on Boston Street in Lynn. Let's go to Jessica Stobbard in the field with this week's Sideline Sportscast.
We're here at DeSimone Fitness with Joe DeSimone. He is the owner and operator of this athletic training facility. So, Joe, how important is the training aspect to an athlete who might be in season or out of a season and kind of just different than the actual fundamental practice?
Sure. In season, we want to maintain strength because injury risk is high in these sports. These athletes are playing a lot of sports, so injury risk is high. So to prevent injury and maintain some level of strength and performance, we want the athletes working out 1 or 2 days a week throughout the entire season. Off season, still worried about injuries, so we want to get the athletes strong as possible for performance enhancement. Sports are very competitive nowadays. These kids are playing multiple sports, and the competition is up. So the stronger athlete is going to be the better athlete.
So we have our intern LaShawn here, and you're going to put him to work a little bit, demonstrating some of the moves that some of these athletes should be doing kind of year round.
So here we got a sled push, working on knee drive, learning how to run, feeling the knee drive. Good. Explosive hip drive, push. Great conditioning, cardio, off season or in season. Medicine ball throws are great for rotational sports like baseball, lacrosse. Keep the athlete explosive in the rotational plane. Kettlebell swings are great for hip explosiveness, conditioning, in season, off season, great exercise. Here we have a single dumbbell chest press, working core and upper body, great pressing movement. It's called the goblet squat. It's a great exercise for the legs, very easy to learn. We want the elbows inside the knees, stay on the heels, keep the head and chest up. Great leg exercise.
All right, awesome workouts, Joe. So if someone wanted to come here on their own or maybe with the team, how can they learn more information?
Sure, they can find out more at DeSimoneFitness.com. We have different types of programs for groups, teams, individuals. We offer it all.
All right, thank you so much, Joe. Right, we're gonna go get LaShawn a nice cold water for all of his hard work. So yeah, great work by our intern, LaShawn. He really got put to work. I actually had to run out and run a quick errand before we started filming. And I go in and him and our other intern, Eli, we're both doing workouts. Joe really kind of puts you to work. He kicks my booty every Monday, Wednesday, Fridays at boot camp. So definitely if you are looking to get in top shape, if you're an athlete out there, definitely go see Joe DeSimone.
Absolutely, great guy and even better trainer. If you have a sports story or just want to give us some feedback, you can visit us at www.lincamtv.com/shows/LynnMASportscast. You can find us on YouTube and Twitter at Lynn Sportscast, as well as Facebook. That's our show for today. We just want to say thank you to our guest and all of you guys at home for tuning in. That's it for this week's edition of the Lynn Mass Sportscast. From the studio here at Lynn Cam TV, I'm Sean Donahue.
And I'm Jessica Starbert. Have an awesome week.